Hello and welcome to the episode 16 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we will see the Beatles playing ping pong between two venues, a hard day turning into a great night, and old lows playing a role in modern times. Let's see. On the 16th of January 1963, the Beatles were busy with two broadcasts from Manchester, England. There was a live TV performance from the Studio 4 of Granada TV Centre for the programme People and Places, and then a recording for BBC Radio's Here We Go at the Playhouse Theatre. At 3 p.m, the band rehearsed their act at the Granada TV Centre. Then, at 4:30, they appeared at the Playhouse Theatre for the BBC Radio's rehearsal. Then, back to the Granada TV Centre where, at 6:35, the Beatles mimed Ask Me Why and Please Please Me during the live broadcast of the show. No rest for the wicked, though. At 8:45 p.m, they were again at the Playhouse Theatre, recording Chains, Please Please Me, Three Cool Cats and Ask Me Why. Here We Go went on air on the 25th of January, but the band's performance of Three Cool Cats was edited out of the programme. In 1964, the Beatles kicked off their three-week residency at the Olympia Theatre in Paris, France, as part of a nine-act bill. They had two or three concerts per day, with only 2 days off, being one of the three most important acts in the show, along with French chanteuse Sylvie Vartan and the American Trini Lopez. The Beatles' repertoire was comprised of From Me to You, Roll Over Beethoven, She Loves You, This Boy, Boys, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Twist and Shout, and Long Tall Sally, although sometimes they left some of the songs out during the afternoon shows. The first concert of the day, a matinee, went down okay, but the evening performance wasn't entirely satisfactory. The audience was composed of Parisian socialites in full evening dress, used to the best entertainment offered in Paris. Not the type of people that the band was congenial with, too polite and composed for a rock and roll concert. In addition, the venue fuses blew three times due to the demands of the modern amplification equipment. There were even some problems on the stage when a French photographer was forbidden to take an exclusive picture of the band and a fist fight erupted, causing the Four to stop playing and George Harrison almost damaging his guitar in the commotion. The night was tense and such a low point in the Beatles' ride to the top that George Harrison even suspected sabotage. The reaction of the public, the chilly reviews of the press, the fist fight, the intervention of the gendarmes and the resulting chaos forced the band and Epstein to enforce a strict policy of no one outside the band's circle being allowed backstage in their dressing rooms. On the other hand, returning to their room at the George V Hotel, the band was greeted with the news that I Want to Hold Your Hand was to be featured in the number one spot of the following week Cashbox single sales chart. They were number one in the United States. When Epstein read the telegram with the news to the lads, their reaction was an explosion of euphoric joy, turning a difficult day into a chance for celebration. The band, Brian Epstein and George Martin, went to dinner together, partying until 5 a.m. The 16th of January 1965 saw the final date of Another Beatles Christmas Show, featuring the Beatles, Freddie and the Dreamers, Sound Incorporated, Elkie Brooks, the Yardbirds, Michael Haslam, the Mike Cotton Sound, and Ray Fell, all introduced on stage by compere Jimmy Savile. The last two houses, as usual, were staged at the Hammersmith Odeon Cinema in London. I wish I could say something epic about the conclusion of this variety show, but really, by this time, it had become a meaningless routine for the Beatles, something they had to do because manager Brian Epstein had talked them into it to rake in more money. 5 years later, in 1970, John Lennon's Bag One exhibition at the London Arts Gallery was raided by the police, who confiscated 8 of the 14 lithographs on grounds of indecency. 50 complete sets of lithographs and 20 indecent prints had already been sold, though. In the end, the director of public persecution decided not to persecute Lennon under the Obscene Publication Act of 1964, as this could lead to censorship of other artworks depicting nude bodies. This didn't mean John was in the clear, though. Under the 1839, yes, that's 1839, Metropolitan Police Act, it was an offense to distribute indecent material in a public thoroughfare. John had to face a trial that eventually turned into a verdict of full discharge, as the London Arts Gallery was ruled not to be a public road. This lesson in urban architecture leads me to the conclusion of this episode of What a Fab Day. Please remember that some of the episodes are being recorded with some extra material. In order to find out how to get them and to find other ways to support my work on this and other musical endeavors, please keep an eye on www.simonmas.com/support. In the description of this episode, you will also find an Amazon affiliate link to buy the sources I've used when writing the podcast, should you want to do some shopping. Remember that buying through the link will not affect the price of the items. It only means that Amazon will part with some of their money, giving me the chance to offer you an even increasing number of podcasts and videos. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.